Tonight we started off with a questionnaire. Have you ever seen a miracle? Check yes or no. Circle, whatever you did, indicate it. Did God use you in performing this miracle? Have you ever seen God interfere with nature to perform a miracle? Did God use you to perform the miracle? Have you ever seen someone healed? And by healed, of course, miraculously healed. Did God heal someone through you? And then finally, did you ever see anyone delivered from demon possession? And did God use you to cast out the demon? We are living in a church world where a lot of churches don't have the presence of God. We've already mentioned that earlier tonight. You know, you walk in and it's dry, it's humdrum, there's not a whole lot going on. And it doesn't matter how many activities they may have going on, you don't feel the presence of God. Then you enter other churches, and of course as we go through tonight, just a side note, we all know I'm not bashing the church, I'm not bashing anybody individually, but yeah, I'm here to challenge us. But we feel the presence of God, but do we have the power of God? Do we have the power of God? We may know how to pray, but do we have the power of God in our lives? In John chapter 14, verses 12 and 13, John 14, 12 and 13. If someone would like to go ahead and read that. John 14, 12 and 13.
Very verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. The greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever he shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son.
So what did Jesus say? He said that he that believeth on me, the works that I do, he shall do also. Does he mention that you have to have the baptism of the Holy Ghost with evidence of speaking in other tongues to perform these works? No, he does not. The simple requirement was he that believeth on him. That is what the Bible states. He that believeth in him. Now, I'm not undermining the baptism of the Holy Ghost in any way. I'm really not. I'm not undermining the gifts. But when it comes to the power of God, he just said, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, he shall do also. But he doesn't stop there. What else did he say?
Greater works.
Greater works. Greater works than these shall he do, because I go to the Father. And he didn't say that you had to stand on top of your tiptoes and pat your head, and rub your tummy, or do vice versa and go back and forth. He said, he that believes on me shall do greater works than I do. For one reason and one reason alone. Because I go to the Father. And he said, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in his Son. He didn't say, whatsoever you ask in my name, I might do it. Or maybe I will. It depends what mood I'm in. He said, I will do it, that the Father may be magnified and glorified. So let me ask you this. Why do you think that we do not see signs and wonders following those that believe? Why don't we see signs and wonders follow? I mean, the simple requirement was he that believeth on him. That was the only requirement. So why don't we see signs and wonders follow? I agree with you 100%. Unbelief. Other reasons would be, I would say, complacency. There are a lot of people, and it's easy to do, to come into church, go through the routine, We sit here, we read the Bible, we listen to the sermon, we go through worship service. That is a whole lot easier than stopping what we're doing in Walmart because the Holy Ghost told us to go pray for somebody, or because we see somebody with an infirmity and go out of our way to lay hands on them. It's a whole lot easier to do something that we're comfortable doing. Just come, sit, do what we have to, and leave. So we have unbelief, we have complacency. Along with unbelief, I would say, we make excuses. I think we are in a church age that not even the liberal church, but the conservative churches make excuses. Well, maybe it wasn't God's will that they be healed, or maybe it wasn't His timing. I think it comes back to unbelief because it didn't happen right then. So we have to make up something. Because it gives us assurance that, well, God's doing what He's supposed to be doing, and it wasn't His timing. Are there any other reasons why we might not see the power of God in our midst? And I don't mean in our midst, but signs and wonders following. So of unbelief. Not expecting it. Maybe our spiritual ears aren't always where they're supposed to be.
Well, you wouldn't call up and express that feeling.
Yeah. No, that's what she said. You are not used to seeing it.
Mm-hmm. I didn't even say it.
It's all right, brother. But when we look at the Word of God,
I would call up and express that. We've seen all of this.
Absolutely. Or maybe it comes back to complacency that we'll let somebody else do it. You know, it's easy, even for somebody who's using the gifts of the Spirit, well, let so-and-so do it. Or when God's moving, God let so-and-so give the interpretation. No, I don't need to do it. So-and-so can do it. I remember the first time I was using the gifts of the Spirit when it comes to tongues and prophecy. God had already started giving me the message. But Mem and Sharon, Sister Deesha, were back there. It's like, God, go ahead and use that. God, you let them go ahead and do it. And as I'm praying, God, you let somebody else do it, all of a sudden the tongues start coming out. So then I'm sitting there praying, you know, God, let somebody else interpret it. Nobody else did, so. And then the Holy Ghost just took over once again. Doesn't normally happen that way, but that incident, He just took over. But we wait for other people to do it. Then there are those of Acts chapter 19, verses 14 through 17. What about if someone would go ahead and read that? Acts 19, 14 through 17. So here we have the seven sons of Sceva. They go to cast out the demon, and why couldn't they cast him out? It wasn't unbelief.
They didn't have the power.
They didn't have the power. Why didn't they have the power? I know now I'm pulling in. But why didn't the sons of Sceva have the power?
No.
Because they didn't have a relationship with Jesus. If we go back to the beginning of verse 14, it tells us exactly who they were. They were sons of the chief priest. They were religious, but they did not have a relationship. So we have the other liberal side of the church. You know, there's lots of people that go to church, but they don't have a relationship with God. They don't have one at all. So for them, they don't have signs and wonders following. But what about those that do have a relationship? Why don't we see signs and wonders following? We look at the early church, and they followed them all the time. And the day after Pentecost, if I'm not mistaken, is the chapter after Pentecost. Chapter after Pentecost, or two chapters. First, one chapter, because it leads into chapter 4, 3, maybe. But I think it leads into 3, and John going to the temple in chapter 4. One chapter over, they're already going to the temple to worship God, and it's just following them. It's just flowing out of them, so to speak, because they're that full of God. Signs and wonders were common for the early church, but they're not common. And loving them all together is the modern day church. You know, even the ones that we come and we feel the presence of God. We don't have the signs following.
I am preaching. If you don't preach, I will be coming out.
To be honest, brother, if they're a Christian, they're not left ignorant because they still have the Word of God. Just because the preacher doesn't preach it, it's not available to them.
But they have the Word of God, but there's nobody telling them that this is the way you put it too.
I agree to a degree, but...
Because they don't even know, because there's nobody that preaching on the power of God anymore.
I agree to a degree because...
There's some that preach on the power of God, but not all. And if they don't understand...
But if they're truly...
Is, if you don't understand... You need to have somebody to explain it to them.
But if they're truly hungry, they will pray and seek for an answer. People have done that about the Pentecostal chapter and the baptism of the Holy Ghost. There might have been no one to teach them, but they have prayed, and God has revealed to them an answer. So, I mean, it's still there, but we overcomplicate things too much, I think. When we look at this passage here back in John chapter 14, he said, those that believe, because I go to my Father. You know, when we look at the life of Christ and listen to his teachings and his parables, how many times did he talk about little children and their father and do comparisons? When I think about my own life, you know how many times I bother my own dad for stuff? And it's not because I expect him to go and say no. In fact, I expect him to say yes. In fact, there's been more than one time that I've taken the truck without asking. There's been more than one time I've gone down, taken a tool, or more. Gotten a phone call about my dad harassing me, saying that he's taking inventory and he's missing some things. Because my dad had access to my grandfather, who... I've used his tools more than plenty of times. In fact, I bumped his ladder for the longest time until I got my own. And I bumped my Uncle Doug's wagon to do stuff. And why was that necessary? And why was that possible? I'm sure Brother Dennis, your kids did the same thing. They come, they need this, they need that. Dad, I need an oil change. Now, let's just take it over to the garage. It's a whole lot easier to do it over there. There are lots of things when it comes to my dad that I don't expect him to say no. I just, Dad, I need this. Okay, just go do it. Dad, I need to borrow $100. It's broken in the house or something. Or, Dad, this happened. I need this. Or there have been times when they just outright offer. You know, you can borrow the money and pay us back when you get it or as you get it. No big deal. Why is that? Because I have access to my Father. What did Jesus say? Yeah, I put my dad through quite a bit. But what did Jesus say? That we shall do greater things. Why? Because he goes to our Father, his body. And do you not think that if my earthly dad will let me do all those things, bum all those things, borrow all these tools, do this, do that, be willing to come and help me with projects, I don't know how many crazy things I've had my dad involved in, or have him truck it up to my house because your mother said I had to come up here. I told her you were fine with electrical work. It was nothing major. I remember one time I was switching last summer. My one ceiling fan died in my office. And we had one in the foyer which never got used. So what did I do? Well, I went to the foyer and I started pulling that one down and switched, flip-flopping them out. And of course, somehow in the meantime, I called Dad to make sure because both wires were black. I wanted to make sure something was kosher before I did it. Next thing you know, about 10 minutes later, because Mom got wind, Dad's chugging up the stairwell, not happily, but he's there. Your mother made me come up. I told her you were fine. But if I would have needed help, he was there to help. There was nothing else than to hold the ceiling fan in place. He was there to help. Why? It's my dad. There's lots of things that he probably wouldn't do for me. Whether he wanted to or not, he'd still do it because I needed help. And I'm sure we can all think the same thing about our earthly fathers if we knew them. How many times have Pat come over and done this, done that, when you're not trying to kill him under the wagon? I'm sure the same is true, Brother Dennis and Brother Leo. You needed help, he was there. Little stuff, he was there. Whatever you needed. Why? Because our Father's there to help. And maybe we've done the same thing to our kids. You know, if you need something, here, let me know, or let's go do this, or if you need to borrow it, it's out in the garage, just grab it. If those are our earthly fathers, how much more does our Heavenly Father want to give us? And how much more do we have access to? Because he's our Father. Now, sometimes he does tell us no. What parent doesn't tell their child no? But when it comes to having signs and wonders following, do you not think that God wants to have signs and wonders follow us? I mean, he's given us, he's told us that they're there. All we have to do is believe on him, believe on Christ. No other requirements. And when we look at the life of Christ, what does John chapter 21 and verse 25 states concerning the works of Christ? John 21:25.
There are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, every one is supposed that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Amen.
John wrote that the works that Christ did, referring to the 3.5 years that he was with him, the books couldn't contain them. He would suppose that even the libraries of the world could not contain the books that could be written, which the miracles that Jesus Christ did in 3.5 years. When you look at the average lifespan of an individual, we have more than 3.5 years. Yes, we're not going around constantly to this city ministering to that person, or traveling here, traveling there. We work jobs. We're more stationary. I realize that. But we all, even though we're stationary, and maybe we're not in the ministries, so to speak, like Jesus was constantly going about the crowd, teaching them, preaching to them, guiding them, we also have a lot longer to reach out to people. We have more than 3.5 years. And what are we doing in that meantime? You know, could the same be said of us, that volumes could not contain the works that God did through us in our lifetime? Could that be said of us? The Bible states that we should do greater things than Christ. When we look at the life of Christ, he healed the sick. He cast down demons. He raised the dead. And volumes could not even contain everything that he's done. He multiplied the bread and the fishes. much more could we do if we allow God to move and work through us? Like I said, we play, and not that there's anything wrong with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and I'm not demeaning it anyway. But some people might use that as an excuse for, they have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, I don't. What am I expected to do? God didn't say you need the baptism of the Holy Ghost to see signs and wonders follow you. He said, they shall follow them which believe. And he went on even farther, that whatsoever ye ask in my name, that will I do, because I, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And then we get to verse 14, which settles every if and or but. In John chapter 14, verse 14, if ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. It doesn't say if you have the baptism of the Holy Ghost in a small print. It says, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, I will do it. But so many times it's just a lot easier to make up excuses. Well, maybe it's not God's timing, or this, that, and the other thing. He said, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, I will do it. In Sunday school, we've been talking about personal evangelism and witnessing. And there have been times in witnessing where you get the person to, I phrase that badly, but you know where I'm coming. You get the person, or the Holy Ghost convicts the person to the point where they accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. But all of a sudden, they're not sure if they're really saved. They don't feel a difference. So what do? You go back and you reiterate, what did Jesus say? And yet, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins. Well, I don't feel it. Well, what does the Bible say? Confess your sins, you're Jesus is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins. I still don't feel it. And you just sometimes you have to reiterate over and over and over. Well, what did Jesus say? If you confess your sins, you'll forgive them. And it's a matter of getting it through to them that is the point. This is what the Bible states. This is true. I remember Sister Goodwin saying in Bible school that she remembered talking to one individual. They went round and round for 10 minutes until finally the individual, yes, I am saved. I confess my sins. Jesus, forgive me. I am saved. Now, I think we have to do that as Christians. We've been Christians so long that we've become accustomed to not seeing signs and wonders follow. And because of that, it's easy to brush it by the wayside. And I think we have to reiterate to ourselves that we don't need the baptism of the Holy Ghost to see signs and wonders. Oh, that's not what the Bible states. But what does the Bible state? If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. That's not taken out of context. That's going right along with everything you say. If ye believe in me, signs and wonders shall follow. Whatsoever you shall ask in my name, I will do it. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. And within three verses, like reiterate it. Sometimes I think we need to reiterate it to ourselves. Why aren't signs and wonders following? Sometimes it's because we need to take action on our part. We need to stop making excuses, and we need to try. We can pray for individuals to get saved all we want. And we can pray that God would save them, and pray that God would save them. But have we told them about Christ? Have we taken the initiative and the action? When we look at healing, in Mark chapter 16 and 17, they said, signs and wonders shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. Verse 18, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Not maybe, not might, but they shall recover. James 5 and 14, is there any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if he hath committed any sins, they shall be forgiven him. Bible doesn't say that these men have to have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. When we look at the elders of the church, if we study it out, it's not necessarily talking about the council. It's not necessarily talking about the pastor. He's talking about men and women of faith, people that will believe unwavering. And it states that they will recover. The prayer of faith will save them. Does not say any stipulation that God might or maybe. We are the ones that put those speculations on there. Why? Because A, it gives us excuses, and B, it gives us an excuse not to try. Is really what it comes down to. Some people are afraid of failure. But if we are truly going to see signs and wonders happen, it's going to be when we take that step of faith and step out, stop making excuses, and actually try. We must put our faith to action. We can pray for our community and for God to send revival. But if we don't take action, it's not going to happen. If we don't tell them about Christ or start witnessing, A, it's not going to happen because we didn't take the initiative. When it comes to revival, B, why should God send revival if we're not willing to take the initiative in the first place and go tell people about Christ? But the same is true when it comes to signs and wonders. If all we do is pray, and we don't put action behind our prayers, we're never going to see anything happen. Charles Finney, when he first got saved, he attended a prayer meeting every week. And every week, they would pray for the lost. They would pray for the lost. But you know how many people in that church that were praying for the lost were out seeking for the lost? None of them. Recorded that he went and attended their prayer meetings for about a year. And he would always pray, so to speak. But he would go there after he would do his homework while he was in seminary in the back. He was newly saved. But he said, then one night at this prayer meeting, someone who wasn't even saved came in and said, you pray for the lost, you pray for us to get saved, but what are you doing to see that we get saved? Are you coming and telling us that we're lost? Are you coming and telling us how to get saved? We need to put action behind our prayers. Why don't we see signs and wonders follow? Probably the large part is because we're not stepping out in faith, taking the initiative, and believing that God's going to do it in the first place. If we are going to see signs and wonders follow, we need to put unbelief aside. And we need to take action. If we're going to see signs and wonders follow, we need to put complacency outside and step outside of our comfort zone, believing that God's going to do something. There's a church called Broadway Assembly in Ohio. Their walls were filled with crutches, canes, wheelchairs, from people that came into service that got prayed for